Good morning. Welcome to New Life Community Wesleyan Church. I'm Pastor Scott Hergert, and I'm glad that you've taken the time to join me today in our worship service. We're continuing on in our study of Hebrews. In just a minute, Josh and Wade are going to come along, and they're going to lead us in our time of worship. Just a couple of announcements. Last Sunday we did have a leadership meeting, and we did talk about reopening the church. And pretty much it was decided that we need to continue with the course that we're on right now, where as long as Wood County is at a red level, we're going to continue to meet virtually to help prevent the spread of the virus and to help protect the people that are around us. But we are going to continue to meet monthly, if only just to discuss that. And we also have a prayer meeting on Wednesday night via Zoom, and I've created a special group on Facebook called Prayer Meeting under the heading of New Life Community Church. So if you would like to participate in that, you need to let me know, and I'll make sure that you get an invitation to that. Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 139. I'm going to read verses 1 through 6 and then verses 13 through 18. Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thoughts afar off. You comprehend my path, my lying down. You are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word on my tongue, but behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You have hedged me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Skipping down to verse 13, for you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret, and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book there were all written. The days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more than a number of the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. May the Lord bless the reading of his word today. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for being such a wonderful, powerful God and having such an intimate knowledge of who we are. As we come to you today, we want to dedicate this time to you, Lord. And we pray that you would just guide us in our thinking, in our understanding. And Lord, use this time to draw us closer to you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. I'm glad you got together today with us to praise and worship. We have a really good line of music today. If it doesn't kill me, I think it's a great worship and praise selection. So with that said, standing on the promises.
Standing on the promise.
God. Like right now, you can know that God is with you, even if there's only two or three of you gathered. He says in His Word, He will be with two or three. And so we know God is with us. We can stand on that promise. Our next song is called One Thing Remains. Thank you. This
Josh and Wade for leading us our worship time today. One of the things I forgot to mention earlier is that the Bowen family will be doing a concert for us tonight at 6 o'clock on Facebook. So if you haven't seen that and you don't have things set up yet, you want to make sure that you do that before 6 o'clock tonight. That'll be a live Facebook concert that they're doing just for us, so we want to make sure that we tune in and support it. Share the post with other people so that other people can participate as well. So that's an exciting thing that we've got going on today. And then also just wanted to remind you once again that we have our receiving offerings through our online offering option through our website, and then also you can mail in checks or find other ways to get that money to us. Some of the prayer requests that have been passed along to me are Jose and Kathy with some of the health problems that they're having. COVID victims and those recovering from COVID. An acquaintance of ours, Dr. Roars, has COVID right now, and we want to pray for him. We know several people that are recovering from it. There was a bit of an outbreak at the nursing home, so we want to pray for those people. And then I can't remember if it's coming up or it's already happened where Ron Monk was having a tooth pulled. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship you, and just what an amazing God you are. As we read in the psalm this morning, how you've carefully knit us together and created us, even before we were formed in our mother's womb, you knew us. How amazing it is for us to consider that you know us that well, that you knew us before we were even created. You knew us before anyone else knew about us. And Lord, that is just amazing to consider and to comprehend. And I am so thankful that I can call you my God, that I can gather with friends and family today and I can worship you. And I am so thankful. I praise you today, Lord, because I know that I am fearfully and wonderfully made. And all of the people that are watching this can say that with me, that they are fearfully and wonderfully made. I thank you, Lord, for your mercy and for your love. And I thank you for the abundance with which you take care of us. We thank you, Lord, for the blessings that we have. We thank you for the meeting that we had on Sunday. And Lord, for the positive results from that. I thank you, Lord, for your love and for your protection in our lives. We can all, anyone who has been able to avoid the coronavirus, can praise God and say thank you for protection from that. And those who have survived can also say thanks. We want to pray today, Lord. Pray for our church, and we ask for our church family that you would continue to bless, that you would enlarge our territory, that you would, that your powerful hand would guide us, and that you would protect us from evil. I pray, Lord, that all that we do and say would bring glory and honor to you, and not just as the church body, but the individuals that make up the church as well. Lord, I pray that we would experience your blessing, even in this time of isolation. I pray, Lord, for your protection and for your guidance. We want to pray also, Lord, for our leaders, and I pray that, especially as the transition of power takes place this week, I pray, Lord, for your guidance, and I pray, Lord, that you would be glorified through this transition of power. We just pray, Lord, for your help and for your direction through all that's going on in our country right now. I pray that you would guide our leaders in the decisions that they have to make concerning the changes in power and concerning the COVID virus and all of the other things. We pray, Lord, for your help and for your guidance there. We want to pray also, Lord, for the people around us that protect us, our first responders, our healthcare professionals, and our military. We pray, Lord, that you would protect them physically, but we ask also, Lord, for spiritual and emotional protection, because so many of the things that they deal with create just emotional problems, and we pray, Lord, for your protection for them in that way. We pray also, Lord, for Jose and Kathy, and we pray that you would help them with the problems that they're struggling with right now. I pray that you would touch their bodies and that you would bring healing. And Lord, we just pray for your strength and for your guidance for them. I pray for Dr. Roars, and I pray that you would protect him during this virus. And I pray that in the name of Jesus Christ, that you would bring healing to his body. and any others who are struggling with this virus right now. We pray that you would bring healing to them. Those that are recovering, Lord, we pray that the side effects would be minimal. Pray for the nursing home, and I pray that you would protect the residents there. And I pray, Lord, that you would just allow the virus to not have a serious negative impact upon that facility. And I pray also, Lord, for Ron as he has a tooth pulled. We pray, Lord, that it would be painless. And I pray, Lord, for a speedy recovery for him. Thank you, Lord, for your presence with us. And as we spend time in your word today, I pray that your Holy Spirit would illuminate your word to us. And we ask this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So like I said earlier, we're going to continue in the book of Hebrews today. You want to open your Bibles up. We're in Hebrews chapter 2, beginning with verse 5. I'm going to read verses 5 through 18, which is the end of chapter 2. And in this passage, I've pulled out four pictures of Jesus that the author seems to focus on here. And as I was thinking about that, I was thinking about a guy that came to work for me at the store recently. And as he came in to do his job, I looked at him, and as I was telling him what needed to be done, I just didn't have a very positive impression of him. There were things that he said, the way that he looked, and just different things there that didn't impress me. But you know, after I got past that, he did really well with the job that he was called upon to do. And I was a little bit embarrassed about the impression, that initial impression that I had of him, that I hadn't been more gracious and understanding to him and really accepted him as being more than what he appeared to be on the outside. But you know, a lot of times I think that other people, as well as me, they do that. Sometimes we go by a first impression, and we allow that to stick with us, and we develop just a strong opinion about that person based on that initial impression. But a lot of times, if we just go based on that first impression, we're going to find out that we were wrong, just like I was in that situation. Well, today, we're looking at these pictures of Jesus. And I think a lot of times people in our world have opinions about Jesus. They have impressions about Jesus. You know, sometimes they may be right, and a lot of times they may be wrong. And as we look at these impressions that people have of Jesus, I believe that these pictures help us to develop a clearer picture, a clearer understanding, I should say, of who Jesus really is. And so as we look at this passage today, I want to share with you four pictures of Jesus that the author of Hebrews has for us. And these will help us to grow in our knowledge and in our understanding of Jesus Christ. And also, I believe, on how we develop as a believer in Jesus Christ. So let's begin reading in Hebrews chapter 2, beginning with verse 5. For he has not put the world to come, of which we speak, in subjection to angels, but went testified in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you take care of him? You've made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor and set him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom all things and by whom all things are, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren, and in the midst of the assembly I will sing praise to you. And again I will put my trust in him. And again here am I, and the children whom God has given me. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed, he does not give to the angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, and he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. May the Lord bless the reading of his word today. The first picture that we are given in this passage is that he is the world ruler. He is the world ruler. In the first chapter 2, beginning with verse 5, those first few verses, they talk about Jesus as being a ruler of the world. And he kind of establishes a hierarchy here. If you look, noticed in the passage, you have God, and then you have the angels, and then you have men who were created a little lower than the angels, and then all of the things that are in the earth are subject to that man, to human beings. And so he kind of develops a hierarchy. And if you think about that, think about when Jesus became man, he became a part of that hierarchy. Well, he was a part of the hierarchy before, but he became a part of the human part of that hierarchy. And so as we look at it, we can see Jesus as at the top of the hierarchy, but then we can also see him taking a place as a human being when he was a human walking on this earth. And so in verse 7, quoting from Psalm chapter 8, the author says, "You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and you set him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet." I think a lot of times we fail to realize as human beings what a wonderful position that God has given to us, that we are in a position of power over the things of the earth. A human being was created by God, but we were created special. We were created in a way that puts us over all of the other things that were created on the earth. And that's an important part of who we are, how we are. We are not in subjection to the things that are on the earth. We are in subjection to God who is above us. But we are over those things which were created in the world. And while we look at that and understand our place in that hierarchy, we also need to understand that Jesus is over us. That Jesus is the one who established us. He's the one who created us. And that we're in a position below him. As we go on in verse 9, it says, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone." And so we see that while Jesus was, as a human being, created in the human image, or created as a human, that doesn't sound right, while Jesus was a human being, he was lower than the angels, but then he graduated to a higher position where he was placed back into God's glory in a position of leadership and authority. Those people who are in military or are familiar with military, you would understand this completely. We've got a hierarchy, and in the military, you know who's above you, you know who's below you, and you know what your position is there and how you are supposed to react with those who are in those other positions. And so this whole idea of subjection is probably a military term, something that was borrowed from the Greek military. There's people above, there's people below. But in this passage, we want to understand that Jesus is superior to all things. He is the ruler of the world. He created the world, he sustains the world, and now he's the one who is the ruler of the world. And we'll get to more of that. But that's the first picture that the author gives to us, is that Jesus is the ruler of the world. The second picture is that he is the Savior. He's the Savior of the world. And so for this, I just want to focus on verse 10. And I want us to understand there is no way for us to get to God without going through Jesus Christ. The only way for us to experience salvation is through Jesus Christ and him alone. That is the only way that we can experience salvation. And the only way for Jesus to save us was for him to become a human being. It wouldn't have happened without Jesus Christ becoming a human being. So let me just look at this verse, and we're going to break it down for a little bit. For it was fitting for him for whom are all things and by whom are all things. And as he's talking about that, he's talking about Jesus in the position of the Creator. Jesus is the one who created all things. And so we understand in this first part that Jesus is the Creator. Everything that we look around us and see are things that were created by God. That's the first part, or the first phrase, the indicator of Jesus as the Savior. The second part, as we go on in that verse, by whom are all things in bringing many sons to glory. And so we need to understand here that it is our salvation is based in Jesus Christ alone. I often tell you there's nothing that you can do to earn your salvation. We have one thing to do in order to achieve salvation, and that is to accept the gift of salvation that Jesus is offering to us. That's simply saying, Lord, I want the forgiveness that you have for me, and I want to follow you the rest of the days of my life. That's our part in salvation. Jesus has done all the heavy lifting for us already. We don't need to be a better person. We don't need to put all kinds of effort into becoming a Christian. We simply need to accept the gift of salvation that Jesus has given to us. And then the third part of this is that Jesus, he says in the last part of verse 10, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. And it almost seems in this passage that the author is trying to indicate that through everything that Jesus went through, the suffering, the death, being separated from God for those 30 whatever years that he was on the earth, that he became more perfect as a result of that. And so we see that Jesus is our Savior in many, many ways in this passage. He's our Creator. He's the only one that we can achieve salvation from. He's our captain. And so we need to understand that Jesus is salvation for us. And that's the only way that we're going to achieve salvation. So as we look at these first two so far, Jesus is the world ruler, but he's also listed as the Savior. And they almost seem to be in contradiction or contrast to each other. But these two things are working together to give us a better picture of who Jesus is. So first off, Jesus is the world ruler. Secondly, Jesus is the Savior. The third picture is he's a brother. He's a brother. And as I was just looking at this, trying to think, how do I understand this whole relationship of Jesus as being our brother? And I thought, when my brother and I get together now, a lot of times we talk about things in the past, things that we did, things that we got away with, things that we tried to do, kind of silly, ridiculous things a lot of times. And there are things that we wish that we had done. There's the things that we talk about are, kind of down-to-earth, silly things. But in this passage, that's the kind of relationship, this picture is that kind of a relationship. It brings Jesus to an earthly position where he's connected with us, much like we would be connected with a brother or with a sibling. So in verse 11, for he says, for both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified, Jesus Christ and us, he's making a connection, are all of one. That connection there. He's saying that we have this familial connection with one another in this passage of Scripture. And that's what these sanctify, those beings, he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified is connecting us with Jesus Christ. In verse 12, verse 11 and 12, he's not ashamed to call them brethren. He says, I will declare your name, my brethren, in the midst of the assembly. I will sing praises to you, from Psalm chapter 22. The author is quoting. And he's just making a connection here, showing he's not afraid to call us brothers. He's not ashamed of us. We're connected with Jesus Christ in this way. And then finally, in verse 13, he makes two more points here. He says, I will put my trust in him, which indicates that, I should say, this is a quote from Isaiah. And, Isaiah went through some terrible things in his life. And he was looking for people that he could trust in and find comfort in. And he's saying, I will put my trust in him. He's putting his trust in Jesus Christ. But then in the last part, he says, here I am. Here am I and the children whom God has given to me. Again, establishing that familial connection. And you know, some of these, sometimes the pictures that we have of Jesus Christ can make him seem distant and untouchable. But in these verses, I think the author wants us to understand that while Jesus appears to be as the ruler, as the Savior, and things that might appear to be distant and out of reach for us, he's also talking about a personal connection that we have with Jesus Christ. A brother is someone who's personal, who's close to us, that we connect with in different ways. And so we have three different pictures here that bring out three different aspects of Jesus Christ, but help us to grow in our relationship with him because we understand that he is these three things. So picture number one, he's the ruler. Picture number two, he is the Savior. Picture number three, he's a brother. And then in the fourth picture, he is high priest. He's high priest. The Jewish idea of a priest was different than what we see in the Catholic faith, because at that time, the Jewish priest, a big part of what he did was offering sacrifices. And those sacrifices were offered for the forgiveness of people's sins. And so many times a Jewish priest would stand there day after day, basically killing these animals, shedding their blood, and going through the required rituals in order for the person to be forgiven of their sin or to have their sin covered. Well, if you look at your Bible there, right between Malachi and Matthew, it typically says New Testament. And New Testament also means new contract or new agreement. Helps us to understand that Jesus is refining the agreement that God had with us. And as we look at this, Jesus, the author just really packs all kinds of information in these last few verses. We're going to try to get through it today. In verse 14, he says, inasmuch then as the children are partaken of flesh and blood, and as Jesus, as the author says this, he's just really talking about that Jesus lived a human life. He's partaking of flesh, he's partaking of blood. He has become a human being. And so in the next sentence, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil. And so as we look at Jesus Christ, his death was something so much more than the death of an average human being. Through Jesus' death, he was able to destroy death, and he was able to put into place the beginning of the destruction of the devil. And so we see Jesus' death set into motion that where the devil is being taken care of, and we're going to see eventually where his power is just completely diminished altogether. You know, as I look at this, in verse 15 he says, and he releases those who fear, through fear of death, all their lifetime are subject to bondage. You know, that's something that people have talked about a lot this year. If we are a Christian, we really don't need to fear death. Death is kind of a graduation ceremony. It's going on from this life to the next. And so several places in Scripture where we see that we shouldn't be fearing death. And people have been talking a lot about that this year, especially with COVID, claiming people are afraid because of the COVID virus. I'm not afraid of dying. I'm afraid of what COVID might do to my body prior to dying. I might be afraid of what other people who don't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. There are other things that I'm fearful of, but I'm not fearful of death. And I hope that we understand that we can be fearful of something, maybe be cautious or concerned, instead of just saying we're fearful. My decision and the board's decision to cancel in-person services was not built out of fear. We want to help prevent the spread of the COVID virus. We want to protect the people that are in our congregation, not saying that we believe that they have anything to be fearful of, but we want to protect people from this virus. I don't want to see people go through the suffering that this virus brings on. But you know, most of you, I'm pretty sure that once you experience death, there's going to be a graduation, but getting there might be not so good. And so we need to be careful as we talk about that whole issue of fear and the things that we are fearful of. I don't believe that my fear has got me in bondage to anything, but maybe it's driven me closer to God. And so as we go on in this passage, in verse 16 he says, "For indeed he does not give aid to the angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham." Pointing out in this passage that the salvation that Jesus offers and the work as the high priest is not for the angels, but the work that he does as high priest is for you and me. It's for human beings, the seed of Abraham, the people that are around us. Those are the ones who are going to benefit from the work of Jesus Christ. And the only way for that to happen was for Jesus to become a human being, to live his life on this earth, to suffer, to die, to experience the resurrection, and then eventually to ascend into heaven. He became human in order for salvation to be able to take place. And then in the last, was it the last verse, or was it in verse 17, "Therefore in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of people." Now I wanted to focus just a minute on that word propitiation. As he says that word propitiation, I think a good definition of that is reconciliation. And for us to understand the need for reconciliation, we need to understand what has happened historically. When Adam and Eve committed their sin, they created a barrier between us and God. And then from the time of Adam and Eve, their sin, until the time that Jesus died on the cross, there was that barrier that prevented us from being able to get to God. But when Jesus, the perfect sacrifice, the perfect high priest, actually laid himself down, not executing an animal, but laying his own life down, he became the sacrifice so that we could be forgiven of our sin, so that we could have a right relationship with God, and abolishing the barrier that separates us from God. And so as we look at this, we understand that Jesus became the perfect sacrifice, and he made reconciliation with God a possibility for us. And the only way for us to experience that is by accepting Jesus as our Savior. And then the last verse, "For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted." Jesus became a human being for that connection with us so that he could be the perfect high priest. And as we look at this, the pictures that are laid out for us in this passage, I see four very different pictures, and yet they're all describing the same person, just different aspects of that person, Jesus Christ. And two lessons that I think are important for us to take away from this. First of all is that Jesus wants us to have salvation. Jesus went to great lengths for us to be able to be forgiven of our sin. He became our high priest. He died so that we could be forgiven of our sins and so that we could have a right relationship with him. That relationship, that death that Jesus died, was so we could have a right relationship with Jesus Christ. And Jesus wants us to have that. He doesn't want us to have to work it out on our own. He doesn't want us to have to struggle to figure out how to get this, but he wants to give it to us as a free gift. And so if you've never accepted the gift of salvation that Jesus is offering, you just need to tell him, "I want that forgiveness, and I want to follow you the rest of the days of my life." And so if you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, that would be my challenge to you, to accept Jesus as your Savior and follow him the rest of the days of your life. And then as believers, it's important for us to know Jesus Christ and to understand him. And so as we've went through this, there's a lot of really deep stuff in here that's hard to wade through and hard to completely understand. But it's important for us to go through this so that as believers in Jesus Christ, we can have a clear picture of who Jesus is